Hello. Welcome to the Hammer Museum. I'm Claudia Bester. I'm the Director of Public Programs. It's my great pleasure to welcome you here today for today's conversation between Sanford Biggers and Marcus Samuelsson. Sanford Biggers is an installation, video, and performance artist whose work has been exhibited worldwide, including at the Tate Britain and Tate Modern, the Whitney Museum of Art, the Studio Museum in Harlem. A native of Los Angeles, Sanford received his MFA from Art Institute of Chicago. He's currently an assistant professor at Columbia University School of Visual Arts, and he has so many big exhibitions going on that it's very hard to keep up. He closed two shows this summer in New York, including a survey show of his work at the Brooklyn Museum called Sweet Funk and Introspective, and Cosmic Voodoo Circus at the Sculpture Center. And he currently has a show at Mass MoCA until October called The Cartographer's Conundrum. Sanford's live performances weave together found images of punk, funk, film noir, sci-fi, traditional Samoan dance, and Buddhism, with original video content and improvised turntablism and VJing. Marcus Samuelsson is the award-winning chef, author, and food activist. Samuelsson is noted for defeating 21 fellow chefs on Bravo's Top Chef Masters, winning $115,000 for the charity UNICEF Tap Project. He's the chef and owner of Red Rooster Harlem in New York City, and his books include Aquavit and the New Scandinavian Cuisine, The Soul of a New Cuisine, New American Table, and his latest book, Yes, Chef, a Memoir. He's had a fascinating life, which is detailed in his new memoir. He was born in Ethiopia and grew up in Sweden. He began his training at the Culinary Institute of Gothenburg in Sweden, and then apprenticed in four-star restaurants in Switzerland. When he moved to New York, he became the executive chef at the exclusive Scandinavian restaurant Aquavit. And while there, he received a three-star rating from the New York Times at age 23, the youngest chef ever to do so. More recently, he cooked the first state dinner for Barack Obama and the Prime Minister of India. And then in 2010, he opened his famous restaurant, Red Rooster Harlem. And very recently, he opened a modern incarnation of the glamorous speakeasies called Ginny's Supper Club. And Chef Samuelsson will be in the lobby after today's talk, or we might move it outside since it's such a beautiful day, to sign copies of his latest book, Yes, Chef, and one more. And we will also have coffee and tea and cookies for everybody just to hang out and mingle and get a chance to talk to these wonderful artists. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Sanford Biggers and Chef Marcus Samuelsson.
Hi.
How's everyone doing?
Good.
So nice of you all to come out.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
So, what are we going to talk about?
This is your hometown, so you should lead. I don't even know what part of L.A. we're in right now.
All right. We are right Westwood, yeah. UCLA.
Yes.
I actually went to elementary school right up the street from here. It's now called Seeds. When I was a kid, it was called UES, University Elementary School.
Yeah.
It's part of UCLA.
What has changed since you went to school? What has changed in this neighborhood since you went to school to now?
I haven't spent that much time here, so I couldn't tell you. My sister used to go to school across the street on Sunset at Marymount for a little while.
Okay.
So I know a lot of neighbors know these places.
Yeah.
What has changed in this neighborhood? What is it now? Westwood used to be the hot spot when I was in junior high school. Well, you'd have your parents drop you off and you'd go and play at the arcade, Westworld Arcade.
Yeah.
And maybe get a falafel or sushi, exotic foods at the time.
That's in the 70s. That's still very advanced, you know?
Yeah.
We didn't have sushi nor falafel in Sweden at that point.
Yeah, well, I imagine. You didn't even have the doner kebab? You didn't have the doner?
It came, the first kebab guy, I actually know the guy. He, he opened 1974,
uh-huh.
The first kebab opened in Sweden, and I always thanked him because what he's done for the sort of Turkish and Middle Eastern culture in Sweden. It's the second most popular food in Sweden today, and it's started in 1974 by one guy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was reading someplace that's actually the most popular food in Germany.
Yeah. Yeah, I know, Berlin.
So it's like basically their hamburger.
Yeah, absolutely. And the window into Turkish culture, and not just Turkish, but other culture because of that, so.
Mm-hmm. So, for you who don't know, Marcus and I have been friends for many years. Became friends, I'd say, in the mid-90s in New York, when we both, I had just moved there, he'd been there a little while before I, and we had mutual friends who introduced us. and we used to hit the party scene in Manhattan pretty fierce back in those days. And, you know, we've done the same in various countries. I visited him once in Stockholm. Wherever we pick up, we pick up. Mm-hmm. And a few months ago, I had a big show at the Brooklyn Museum. And as part of it, they traditionally ask artists when they have a large solo show to invite a critic or another artist and have a question and answer or a dialogue. And I wanted to change the format, so I invited two friends of mine who I thought had very similar trajectories as myself and probably had some similar experiences, but a lot of different experiences as well. And it was Marcus and Mostef, who is now named Yasin Bey, mm-hmm. At least for today.
Yeah.
I'm joking. And since then, there's been many opportunities where, you know, as I mentioned, we've both been very supportive of each other's career. And interestingly enough, being an artist and being an artist, there are similar circles that we run in.
Very.
I mean, I was just in Aspen a few weeks ago, and I was hanging out with people who you were hanging out with like the week before for food and wine. Mm. And, you know, as you can imagine, those demographics start to influence each other. So we have a lot of stuff in common. I have artwork in his famous restaurant, the Red Rooster in Harlem. Those of you who have not been, next time you're in New York, please go see it. Go check out the Red Rooster, if you can get a reservation. Or check out Jenny's downstairs, where it's a premier supper club in Harlem.
Yeah.
Roberta Flack performed there.
Jimmy Scott.
Little Jimmy Scott performed there. This is all in the last few weeks. And as you know, many of these people don't perform much at all. And Robert Glasper.
Yeah. But one of the things that I love about your journey is that it's slash art, but it's also craftsmanship, the love for the craft of the art. And you pick that up wherever you are in the world, you know, whether that's Poland, whether that's Sweden, whether that's Japan. And as a chef, I had to do the same thing. I had to go to, you know, when you come from a small country like Sweden, pretty early do you realize that you have to leave in order to learn more, whether that for me was Switzerland, France, or Japan. But so if you go into a place, how do you first decide, especially 15 years ago, how did you decide to, you know what, I think I'm going to go and work in Russia or in Poland?
Mm-hmm.
How did that come about?
It's actually a very interesting story. Part of it was, like you say, I think as an artist, you have to expose yourself to many people, many places, many cultures to understand what your voice is and what your message may be.
Mm-hmm.
Also, there was a practical issue. Being a sculptor, or actually an interdisciplinary artist coming out of grad school in the late 90s, I really didn't know how I was gonna make a living.
Yeah.
So I had plan Bs set up. One would be a teacher or an academic,
of course,
which I am.
Yeah.
And the other would be to do residencies and to find places that would host me for a while, give me the means to make work, and then give me an opportunity to show it and increase my network and visibility.
Mm.
So coming out of grad school from the Art Institute of Chicago, I went to, I moved to New York and did a residency at the Studio Museum in Harlem.
2001, right?
2000. So I did a residency at Studio Museum in Harlem and PS1.
Wow.
And from there, and this is what I tell my students, is that to be an artist of any kind, you have to be nimble, you have to be flexible.
Mm-hmm.
There's, you know, one thing to be a master of your craft, which of course, there's very little compromise there. But in other aspects, you have to find ways to make things happen. There's a phrase I often give them, don't make art to make money to make art.
Mm-hmm.
And another phrase is, like I said, you have to be nimble and flexible. So I started to apply to international residencies, which took me to Budapest for 5 months, or Poland for 6 months, or Japan for 4 or 5 months, or even San Francisco for half a year. So I was moving a lot. And
what was the black population in Poland at that time?
Well, there was me and a couple of football players that would probably go through every now and then. There were basketball players.
But my point of that is, like, as black people, we've constantly had to teach ourselves. There's so much about cooking for me was, sometimes it was obviously very relevant. I was there. I was the only one. It was so obvious. But 90% of the time, it had no purpose. It was just, I was there as a young cook, and I was happy that I had a chance to work on my craft.
Mm-hmm.
And once I got in, I was, you know, they saw that I wasn't dangerous. I'm not going to rob them. Everything's going to be fine. First, we got over those sort of basic hurdles, right? And then you realize how much you share with people that don't necessarily look like you or grew up like you at all, but it was a love for cooking, love for the craft, and what I always talk about, the hidden paycheck, mm-hmm. right? If you're gonna work as a chef at any age, you have to constantly look at the opportunities that the hidden paycheck, like there's something there else that's much more than the monetary that you're gonna get. Mm-hmm. And if you don't see that, I don't think you can be a chef. Mm-hmm. I don't think you can do it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, for a lot of young black cooks, that's difficult because maybe they come from a lesser economy, they're not like trust fund babies that can travel around. But then I always say, well, then you have to work really, really hard for 3-4 months somewhere else. Doesn't matter if you're a bartender, whatever you do, mm-hmm. to get up to get some cash and then go. My biggest success here, I always say, is when I went to France. I got the chance to get a job in France to work for free for a year. Mm-hmm. That's the most successful I've ever felt, mm-hmm. for free. Mm-hmm. So same thing when you do a residency, it's not like, oh, there's a big salary for me there. It's like,
no, you know. It's just, you know, room and board and yeah. a room to work, which is a lot, you know, yeah. at a certain stage. But, you know, the consequences, I had an exhibition in Warsaw and Budapest
wow.
and London and Tokyo. And those things are on my resume. So
wow.
before I'm even showing in New York, I already have an international resume. So then when I show at the Whitney, I'm just like all the other bigger names that I haven't shown with an international, you know, listing of showing. So it's a way of strategizing. You know, it's about chess, not checkers. So
yeah.
each step counts. Yeah.
yeah. But it is, I do think there's another, every ethnic group, you know, what you have this hat on and, you know, you figure out how to hold on to your craft, but also your dream. And in what I always feel like what you guys have done in the art world, there is a whole movement of a legacy of known African-American artists, whether it's Romar or whether it's Lawrence or whether it's today, like your generation with Glenn a little bit before you and Julie and Kara and your generation. There's a legacy. In cooking, everyone knew that black people cooked and served.
Sure.
They just didn't have the titles as chefs. Mm-hmm. So for me, so much about the book, Yes Chef, and so much about my journey is about going from the sort of anonymous laborer to the visible laborer.
Mm-hmm.
Because within that, there is rise in the profession, and people can actually think about, well, we're going to this chef, he happens to be black, he's an amazing chef.
Mm-hmm.
And that journey is very, very important. And I think it's, at some point, both cooking and the art world can be very homogenous, but so, you know, when you were in Aspen the other week, I'm sure you were the only one looking like you there.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, the thing is, the art world is maybe a half a decade ahead
mm-hmm.
of, you know, the cooking game. Maybe
yeah.
a decade.
Yeah.
There are a lot, and maybe because I'm one of them, I see it this way. But there are a lot more black, visible black
Absolutely.
Artists. And when I say, you know, artists of color, it's not just men, it's actually women. So
yeah.
we've even crossed the gender line to a degree.
Yeah.
Whether they catch the same prices as their non-brown contemporaries is another conversation.
Mm.
But the visibility is there.
Yeah.
And I could say a lot of that comes from what happens right across the street from you at Studio Museum in Harlem.
Yeah.
There have been a lot of important figures, but I think Thelma Golden
mm-hmm.
and the string of shows that she did that ushered in the quote-unquote post-black movement.
Yeah.
have gained so much visibility for artists my age and younger and older. So finally we're getting our moment, and I think the moment's getting more and more solid. It doesn't seem like a flash in the pan because
no.
now we're not all doing black shows and now we're not all doing hip hop shows. So that means it's we've gone past some trends,
yeah.
which is a good thing. But I was wondering in your field, because you talk about this a lot, and how do you deal with sort of that irony of working in elite kitchens and there are no women or very few people
yeah.
of color, but in the real world, women in the kitchen is almost a ubiquitous thing that we all grow up in. That's the reason half of us are here living. So
absolutely. It's a great question. I mean, basically my journey of, I went from Sweden to Switzerland, to France, to Austria, and then to the States. And basically in all those kitchens, there was very few women. There was no people of color. So I had to create the space first. But what it did to me was also made me realize the laws on how I want to run the kitchen was crafted in the early 90s. So if you go to Rooster today, it's 50-50. I always said I have a 50-50 rule, right? 50% women, 50% men. And, you know, it's interesting because I do think most women and young female chefs are just better at cooking than the boys. They can be moved around in the kitchen at different stations. Now, cooking on a line is very much like being an athlete. It takes a lot out of you. There's a physicality that fits a lot of the young guys. Mm-hmm. But pure cooking and getting that la familia feel, that sense of je ne sais quoi, that moves this dish over to being a family meal. Mm-hmm. A lot of guys had to train to get that because they want to show, hey, I can get this tomato to look like a carrot, and then I can get it to look like a sea urchin. When all you wanted on a Sunday was like the tomato to look like a tomato.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So it's with cooking. What I learned a lot in Rooster was, I wanted to be more hug, more than this, right?
Yeah.
And that type of cooking.
Yeah. So more comforting than a macho statement.
Yeah. Look, what we can do is not always a statement. And for many years, when you went to Real French Kitchen, it was all about, look what we can do and what you cannot do.
Right.
And you need a little bit of that in a high-end kitchen too, but there's a balance.
Mm-hmm. Well, physicality is also a big thing in both of our fields, of course.
Yeah.
Just the aspect of being on the line and just working and being a sculptor and, you know, the materials and the projects that I involve myself with. But also there's the kind of thing that's projected on our physicality. Mm-hmm. And you've touched on that a little bit, but I've seen you in action at the Rooster and even at Aquavit. Mm-hmm. And heard people talking, because I can be the fly on the wall there.
Yeah.
So I hear what they're thinking when you walk through the room.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's different at Rooster because that's your spot. But at Aquavit, it was like you would walk through that room or they would see a glimpse of you.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like, to some degree, you were like a main attraction there. Beyond the food, they were just like so just amazed and enthralled by you. And the Swedes, of course, were, you know, a lot of the main demographic there. But you had already sort of garnered a certain persona there. It was very interesting.
I mean, cooking, if I would have known how hard it would have been in cooking, you know, from an outside looking in, it's a field that it doesn't make sense for anybody else but the people who are in there, right? You know, I have every scar I have. I've got a plate thrown in my face. I got scallops seared in my I said, I don't have to get tattoos. I have fresh tattoos in my face from French chefs. But never when I got those things did I think about that he did that because I was black.
Mm-hmm.
Never.
Mm-hmm.
I was a young cook and I made a mistake, and I probably deserved a seared scallop in my face at that point. But, so the physicality comes out in so many different ways, right? But it's also a place of love. And that's the thing that mentorship and kitchen is, like, people don't necessarily see. The reason why the only call out is yes, chef, is because first you call yes, chef, because you're part of that kitchen, and then you get yes, chef back.
Mm-hmm.
But there is years in between there. And you can be really hard on people if they know that they got you. They're in, and they know that you have them.
Mm-hmm.
And what I mean with that is also the responsibility that I got was, if I have this young 22-year-old person working with me, giving me 12 hours a day, 2 years later, they're working at Danielle.
Mm-hmm.
Or I got them. We're setting them up to the next level. So it works perfectly when there is a mentee and a mentorship, and nobody abuses a relationship, essentially.
Yeah, it's been an interesting thing for me to partake in that because, you know, of course, artists throughout the centuries have gone through that mentee-mentorship relationship. And I was very fortunate, even as an undergrad at Morehouse, that did not have an art department, that my instructor, who saw me as, you know, very serious and full of integrity and hungry, was able to secure me jobs as an assistant or an apprentice for other sculptors around Atlanta at the time. So I was outside of school, you know, going with to a job where I was learning how to weld and forge and all these things.
What was the art scene in Atlanta? Because I don't know the art scene in Atlanta, but what was that like in the 90s?
You know, in the 90s, it's hard to say. Because I was so green that I didn't know much beyond the walls of, you know, either Morehouse or the Atlanta University Center or those schools at all. I didn't really know much about the art world. I didn't know there was an art world.
Was good.
I think it was actually very good. So I learned a lot of art from books in my art history classes or working with these different sculptors and then going to see their shows or being put in contests that they put me in.
Mm.
And even then, I was still sort of working in a vacuum. And from there, I moved to Japan, and I would say it was probably 6 or 7 years before I went to grad school and got totally embedded in issues involving, you know, modern contemporary art.
It's funny, we both went at some point to Japan. And I mean, I remember every step of how different it was, how from people want to come up and touch your skin to, but also aesthetically and smell, and every level that I think Japan for me was where Europe and America, there are similarities, but when I came to Japan, was one of the first times I realized, wow, this is a different world out there. It's just not Europe and America. Sure. I hadn't even connected with Africa at the same level yet. But when I came to Japan, I was like, wow, this is a big moment. How was, you know, because just eating raw fish, and fermentation, and completely water-based cuisine. How was Japan for you?
I still call it my spiritual home. I mean, for me, it was the place, yeah, once again, it was outside of the Western paradigm. It was totally different. Going back now, I realize that there's so much American influence in various parts, specifically Tokyo. Mm-hmm. But I didn't live in Tokyo. I lived in Nagoya, which is the fourth largest city there. So I had to learn Japanese. And at a certain point, most of my friends were Japanese. But the thing that is interesting that I learned there that made it easy for me to navigate, much easier than my friends from Australia or New Zealand or the UK or from America, mm-hmm. was they have these concepts about tatemae and hone. Tatemae is sort of like the front face. Mm-hmm. This is what you take to work. This is what you wear in a professional environment. This is deference. This is how you treat elders. And then there's hone, which is like bone or your true self, mm-hmm. which you show to your lover or your family or your siblings. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was very much sort of like double consciousness or sort of that middle way, which is, you know, talked about in Buddhism a lot. But also I think, you know, minority Americans, whatever the ilk, have to find a way of navigating society, which means there are sometimes code switching that has to happen. So I found that very easy to understand in Japan. So I never felt, oh, I can't go into this place, but I'm an American. I never felt that for a moment. But when I started speaking Japanese, the places where my American friends could not go, I could go.
Yeah.
So, it was, you know, once again, it was a matter of deference, paying some dues, and being humble enough to learn the lesson and then be rewarded by access. Mm-hmm.
One of the things that both you and I have in our worlds is critics. Many critics.
Really?
So how do you deal with critics? I wanted to put it on the show.
Yeah. Thanks.
How do you deal with
it? Critics, yeah, they're a fun bunch. I'd like to buy them a lot of drinks.
Okay, good. So it's the same trick then.
So critics, some have been very good, some have been very mean-spirited, but some have just been tough in a good way. And I think as an artist or any creator, you have to be able to, you know, take a punch. Because sometimes it's right. You know, sometimes they're going to push you to the next level.
Nice.
Other times it's like, you know, they didn't do their research. You know, I've had reviews where it's like, you missed the whole point.
Yeah.
And not, you know, everyone claims that people missed the point. But when you're, you know, referring to somebody else's work while you're critiquing mine, thinking that was my work, you didn't do the work.
Yeah.
You didn't do the research.
Yeah,
so it's very obvious. So you could dispel some things. But sometimes there's a critic that hits you sort of, you know, you get a hard punch, you get a little koof.
Yeah.
And when that happens, you have to like, okay, well, wait, man, okay, I see it. All right. Oops. So I try to look at it as a learning opportunity if possible. If not, you could just dispel it.
But, you know, in music and in, it's sort of the hip-hop critic does the hip-hop stuff and so on, right? Well, they're classical, that's a classical. But, you know, when I really got punched by a critic was when I started to cook African food. Mm-hmm. And I always felt like, well, wait a minute. You're entering different textures, different spices, there's different notes. And so much about a critic is, so much about cooking is like this tongue-in-cheek, there's a riff off a pesto. That means that you already know what a pesto is.
Right.
But so much of the African food, they didn't even know where my riff came from, right? Mm-hmm. So if I did a play or a peanut soup from Ghana, and they've never had that, then it becomes, I realized maybe I stretched it too far. Mm-hmm. But I didn't want to stop. I'm going to continue to do it. But that was one of the hardest things for me to sort of bring in Africa into the fine dining game. And realize that I lost the ethnic side of it because I wanted to do a modern spin on it. Mm-hmm. And there was nobody there underneath it to support it, mm-hmm. right? if you spin a Swedish dish with a little bit Japanese, there's still enough cultural texture to understand the European or the Asian high-end cooking style. But with Africa, it was just lost. It just became lost in translation. So that was a checkmate for me a little bit, and I didn't, it took me a while to...
That's very interesting.
Yeah.
I mean, I just had, you know, and this is just being very personal and, you know, speaking freely. So of these string of shows that I had from 2011 to 2012, the show I had in Brooklyn was a 10-year survey, and it's work that I'd already done, and, you know, we were speaking a little bit before. As creators, when you've done something, it's done. So when the critics are looking at it or, you know, viewers are coming to see it, you've already moved on. You're on another whole other page, another chapter. And now they're looking at this and they're judging and they're critiquing it, even though you might have already gone to the next level. They don't know it yet, so you have to suck it up. Well, consequently for this show, and by nature of the museum, which serves, you know, Brooklyn, so it's a very, you know, it's folks. It's not all art heads. It's folks. So they have to provide a lot of wall text. And my work has meanings. It has very, you know, lots of layers of meaning embedded in it. And I had to, you know, develop some wall text, and they demanded having this wall text that explained the pieces, you know, sort of the ABCs of the pieces, which was helpful for people who don't have any art background, but it's talking down to people who do have some type of art background and makes them lose interest, or sometimes takes the mystery away from the work. So as a consequence, the next show I did in Massachusetts, I went really deep into some, you know, I call it the cartographer's conundrum, and I'm dealing with issues of Afrofuturism and sacred geometry and the work of John Biggers and their sound and there's sculpture and video. It's all mixed up and it's all crazy. And I provided no wall text at all. There's just a little paragraph that explains the idea of the show.
Yeah.
And I was like, have at it. Let's see what you got.
Yeah.
You know, and out of four or five critics, you know, the first one blasted it. And the next two or three, you know, they came in and took a stab and then they said, you know, they literally said to the curators, like, I'm going to go back and do a little research before I come see the show again. Because I don't want to speak too soon.
Yeah.
And, you know, they did the work, and each subsequent review that's been coming out, and it's not even about the reviews, it's more about the dialogue that some people are actually expanding their knowledge base to understand this. So I understand what you're saying about if people don't have that common denominator, it's hard for them to really understand the riff and what's happening. But I think, you know, both of us, I mean, you have a different... I mean, you ultimately have to keep these doors open. So you have to do what you have to do. So there's a bit of...
No, we definitely have to...
Curating, you have to do that.
You definitely have to sell. You have rent, you have staff, and it's definitely something that I think that a chef thinks about, filling those seats. And then there is, you know, how to go about that has completely changed from when I started, right? Back in the day, it was to work for a French restaurant. You serve basically the 1% of the population. Fine dining was this... conversation that the Michelin guy decided everything. Today, and to want to have a fine dining or establishment in Harlem, it's the opposite. You know, we use a lot of social media. You know, I asked, before we opened the restaurant, I went on Twitter and asked things like, hey, vintage plates or new plates? And right away, you got to respond to where it's at. I asked, I included the anticipation of the restaurant, included the audience already in, but some, you know, some challenges that we had, you know. And it was a, some people anticipated a restaurant and felt a sense of ownership of the restaurant. So we had that positive wave that we really needed. Because the whole idea about the principle of the restaurant was that, you know, why should we have lower amenities north of 96th Street? How can we change the footprint of dining? How can we get people to say, I'm going to go uptown tonight? How can we break this sense of bedroom community where I work downtown, but I live uptown, but I jump on the train and just go back down to work. Or, and tell your coworkers, hey, come uptown tonight. And I think so much of that first chapter has been done. The second chapter of the restaurant is, can we get professionals to come to Harlem to work? And out of those professionals, will there be other restaurants, bars, farmers markets in that community? Now, it's a little bit too early in the game after 18 months, but we definitely training. You know, we have 110 staff and 80% of them come from, 70% of them come from Harlem. So maybe in 2-3 years, we will see how many culinarians, how many maitre d's, because, you know, black people had to work really hard to get out of the kitchen, and now they have to work even harder to get back into the kitchen, which is fascinating by itself.
You know what's really interesting? And I don't know how many of you know this intersection of 125th and Lenox, but if you have been to New York over the last 18 months, I'd say in the last, 18 months, 2 years, there has been a dramatic change in the landscape in terms of bars, bistros, brasserie, restaurants.
Jobs.
Yeah, and, you know, I don't know if you can take all the credit, but you might actually be able to take a good amount of credit. You might be able, listen, because there's across the street, what is, you got the, Corner Social, and then Cove, I mean, whatever. So there's a bunch of places now. So when you go, it's a destination. Coming uptown above 116 on Frederick Douglass, 125th is a destination. You can get your whole night done uptown now.
Yeah.
And there was years, I mean, I lived up there for 12 years, and there was nothing to do. I mean, you know, you went to the hood spot, and that was cool, and that's only for the people who were down to go to the hood spot.
Yeah.
You know, other people didn't want to go to the hood spot. Or you go to the nice place, but the nice place was charging more than downtown spots, you know? So finally, I think there's a
But it's a sense of bringing back normal. You know, a normal community has a bookstore, a normal community have a restaurant, they have a farmer's market, they have a museum like the Studio Museum. So it's about bringing normalcy back. And I always say, people say, Harlem is booming. But, you know, I think if you would take 90% of the communities in the rest of the country, they wouldn't swap in a heartbeat. Because we still have, you know, I just learned today, we have 14%, you know, we have 90% unemployment in Harlem, 40% among African-American men. You know, nationwide for African-Americans is 14.4. Nationwide unemployment is 8.2, right? So as booming as that community is, I don't see a lot of communities switching.
Right.
So at least providing 200 jobs that corner now is doing, not just with Rooster, but with all that, that's a very important, meaningful, that means so much in that community.
Mm-hmm.
So I hope there's just more.
So I gotta ask you this. What's your most embarrassing moment?
They happen all the time, all the time. I tell you, in the kitchen, I tell you that I just remember this one New Year's Eve with being in Switzerland and just working really, really hard. But I missed when I did this asparagus tureen, and I missed, you know, just missed, read the recipe because the recipe was in French. I got yelled at in German and somewhere in that. So I made this tureen for New Year's Eve and it didn't work out. And I was ready to slice the tureen and it was 200 people and chef just sees it's just falling apart, right? And I was like, okay, he's gonna yell at me for 2 minutes. And I'm almost had like, after 2 minutes, it's good, right?
Mm-hmm.
But he didn't stop. He stayed the whole night with me, the whole night. He was just screaming and yelling, screaming and yelling, screaming and yelling. So the next day, so I went, after that service, I just went to say goodnight to everybody and goodbye, because I was convinced that I would get fired. I was convinced that I would get fired. New Year's Eve, I'm sort of, my friends are out partying, I'm packing my bag. And then the next day, I was like, you know what? I'm going to go to work anyway, just see what's going to happen. And then, by the draw of my luck, it was like my friends had been out partying so much, so everybody else was late. So it was me and chef. I had to do breakfast. And all of a sudden, I was in need. So I still thank all my buddies for going out partying really hard. And that's why I can sit here with you. So you never know. Just go back to work.
That's good.
How about you? You felt like you were a ride, and you feel like, you know, and then boom, the night just changed.
Let's see, most embarrassing art moment. Actually, I have one that's better. That also has to do with
Germany. Oh, good. I like
it. Has nothing to do with art, though.
Yeah.
can I digress? Is that all right? All right. So, okay. Well, there's a little art in there. I was doing a residency, so there's the art part. Got that out of the way. I was in Stuttgart, Germany, and and some friends of mine, I just got to this residency like for a week, and you know, it was an international group of people. There was you know, someone from Lebanon, this guy from Canada, this woman from Germany, and this brother from Brooklyn, actually, who they started going to these natural mineral baths. So they were like, all right, here's a new kid, let's take him to the mineral bath. I'm like, okay, great. So I go, and it's like this, you know, water-themed spa mineral bath place. You got families on one section, and then you got the nudist section.
Yeah.
And of course, being the artist, we of course bohemian up to the nudist part. And we're there. And everything's good. It's, you know, people are looking at us a little bit. You know, we're pretty young, and you know, we're definitely the eye candy of the moment, I guess. So we're going to all the different stations. You know, the hot rooms, the cold rooms, the water rooms, dry rooms, the whole thing, and it was great. So great that I decided to go back. Oh, I leave one part out. There was this one room where there's this huge pool, and everybody can get in the pool, and you know, it was, you know, co-ed and nude, and totally respectful, fine. Showers were a little weird, that was a little weird, but we'll get to that.
Yeah.
So I decided to go back the next week. I was like, I'm gonna go check out this place. And I went, and I went to the nude section again, and I was by myself this time, and everything was great, having a blast. And I decided, you know, just like my ritual from the week before, I'm gonna go into the nude pool. So, you know, I go in there and, you know, take off my flip-flops and I get into the water and I'm walking to a little corner where I can just sort of sit. And as I'm walking through this long pool, I'm looking around and I'm seeing people look at me. They all look at me a little funny. And I'm like, okay. And then I get over to the section and I get my little, you know, I'm trying to chill a little bit, get my little section, and I'm like this, and I'm looking around and people are looking and some kids are giggling. And then I was like, oh my God. Everyone in here has a swimsuit on like me. And I see the lifeguard start walking towards me.
Yeah.
And I'm like,
And he's that side.
And he looks at me and he just has this look. He's like, and I'm like, I'm looking at him like, he's like, yeah.
Yeah.
He didn't even say that. He's just looking at me like,
Yeah.
Turns out, since I couldn't read German at that point, it said, on Thursdays from 6 to 8, new moment. The rest of the time, family time.
Yeah.
So I got to do the walk of shame.
Yeah.
Only brother in the room, buck naked. I was so embarrassed I forgot my flip-flops.
That's great.
Anyway, so I had another question for you. How does emotion influence your work as a creator, as you develop new cuisine? How does emotion play on? Tell me about that process.
Well, it's super important because it has to be connective when you make it, but also then you want your guests to sense that, to understand it. And we can't leave them with a text. It's our engaged or disengaged server that is telling us that. And that's why chefs get so upset, because it's a lot of emotion to developing a dish. And for example, a lot of that comes from one dish, like a foie gras dish. I know it's banned in California, but can you use chicken liver? You know, a lot of that love for that dish came from me just cleaning a lot of foie gras in France. And as I started to clean the foie gras a lot, I knew how I wanted to develop this dish. And so I go through this process of sort of making a batter, cooking on really high heat, leaving it gooey inside, and it's very difficult to do. But I knew emotionally before I knew how to taste it, what I wanted to create. I wanted crisp on the outside, super moist on the inside, rich velvet of foie gras. And that really comes from just being and cleaning that foie gras many, many times, knowing at some point what I didn't want to create, because I didn't want to reproduce what they're doing here in France and just adding a new spice in, because that was still not authorship. So much of what I do is based on authorship, because so much of the food has a balance, right? Of people already know chicken is a chicken. In Harlem, it's going to search fried chicken. Well, there's about 500,000 fried chicken experts. So how do you get authorship on something that has been there way before you? It's not like a canvas where you can actually be inspired, but you can take it to whatever direction you want. So the emotional part of it is key, but also connecting on numerous levels. So I try to connect on texture, aesthetic, thinking about it from an artist's point of view, actually, positive and negative space. You bring in things like umami, where most people have had it without even thinking about it. Mm-hmm. But now it's so common, so now people even know what that is. And heat. Heat is still, especially in America, it's a place where we're still not that comfortable with. So there's a space that you can go and show authorship in. But you have to be emotionally connected to it. For me, I learned mostly about my emotions in terms of food from two places. My grandmother, what she taught me growing up as a maid. And started working at 11 years old. No one ever asked her if she had a good day at work. and my when I started to learn about my Ethiopian side, which I wasn't that open to learning about first, but it wasn't until I sort of went to Ethiopia many times, started to understand the culture, and started to understand that this was actually about me. I had to learn this type of food, this type of culture, and that was sort of the last leg for me, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I know it's a very big part of my process as well, and you know, a friend, actually we were at the Rooster the other night, and somebody saw the quilt that I have on the wall there, and they were asking, does it hurt to let these things go? And there was a time when it did hurt a lot. Now I want them to go. I'm like, please take them. But there was a point where it was very difficult to let them go, not because I was so attached to the work itself, but I was attached to the things I learned and how I developed and evolved as an artist while making each piece. Whenever I'm in that creative process, it's a time where I'm actually probably less conscious than I am in any given moment. I don't think about my moves when I'm making art. That's the fun part about making art. I trust my senses, I trust my eye, I trust my hands. And I think a lot of that came from, you know, also another female source, you know, my mom. Hanging out with my mom as she used to take me to the garment, you know, go to the garment district to find fabrics and stuff to make the kind of outfits that she wanted to wear, because she wasn't going to go to the store and drop $5,000 on it, but she'll go down and pick up, the, you know, some cloth and make it, you know. Sitting by the sewing machine and watching her do that, or watching her knit and all those different things. So I have that sort of embedded hand motion, memory, emotion connection there. So when I do big pieces, even like the one that's up here, this was a particularly emotional installation. This is the one that's in Massachusetts. Yeah. I'm flipping really quickly. But this space right here is larger than a football field.
Oh, wow.
And there was no way for me to figure out how to fill that space up before actually going there and just making it happen on site. I had models, I had computer renderings, I had little models in my studio, and nothing made sense.
Yeah.
And then I had to go there and actually start putting pianos in the space, putting church pews in the space, and start to see, how am I going to really rock this space? Because otherwise, whenever I walked in that room, it was like getting kicked in the gut. And I never felt comfortable with that installation until the day it opened and I saw people in there, because that's the next thing. I'm sure that's the next part of your process. Yeah. The creation is only one thing.
Yes.
It's only real when it's being experienced.
And you get a call and respond. You get a response.
You get the call and response, exactly.
But for example, when you did the praying piece in on 126 and 7th Avenue, about eight years ago.
Wait, I think I have a picture of that here.
When you did that, did you map that out in the studio first? Or how did that come about?
No, that was all done. Oh, sorry. That was all done on site. We're
explain to them what it was, because it's an incredible praying mat.
Yeah, it was a large prayer rug. In fact, I know I can find it very quickly if you guys will talk for a second.
Yeah, no, I thought it was fascinating. I mean, a couple of things I think is fascinating with Sanford is that he's a true artist for me because of the fact that you also go back to music very often, right?
Mm-hmm.
And does all of that help you when you paint and then you've been in sculptures and then installation and then go back to music? So music almost becomes like that fourth or fifth spot for you that is public to some, but it's not uber public. It's not like you're out with it that much. I mean, we know and you do things, but music, for me, the way I worked, I always write things down. I go to museums, I go to libraries. Then I draw it out, and then I create my menu based on that. But it's all the works before that that make me come to this point, right? Mm-hmm. For you, what does music fit into this whole thing?
Music, I think, also influences the way I work because of improvisation and the communication that's involved between musicians, whether it be studio situations or live. I mean, I see one of my music colleagues right here, Jahi. So, you know, there's a lot of fun and a lot of camaraderie, but it's also knowing your spot. Knowing what Jahi's strength is, knowing what Martin Luther's strength is, knowing what Saul's strength is, knowing what my strength is, knowing when to play front and play back.
Yeah.
And when making a piece, even making something like this, this is 20 feet by 40 feet. Sorry that the image is a little cropped, but we're improvising.
This is like a masterpiece. This is incredible.
This is colored sand poured directly on the floor.
Wow.
You're
So if you sneeze, this thing.
But it's also when it was put out. I mean, right post 9/11.
Yeah, post 9/11. So this was a way of looking at more of the beautiful aspects of the Arab world and mm-hmm. you know Islam, as opposed to all the hate and fear that was generated in New York, specifically in the U.S. at that time. But anyway, music sort of, you know, also the big part of music is improvisation. And I like to think that I have that flexibility to improvise and make things happen as a creator. Mm-hmm. This was done on site. I didn't map it out. I couldn't map it out. There's no way I was going to do, you know, the 300 hours to do this in my studio and then redo it. So
yeah,
plus the materials and the costs and so on. So once again, I had a good friend. I don't know if you ever met my friend Adia, but Adia came with me to the space. And I basically just mapped out with blue tape on the floor exactly where I wanted the lines to go. And I told her, I taught her how I like to pour the sand. And then she ended up teaching four other people. And we worked from the top part, like right around here. Yeah. And worked all the way down, to make this piece.
Unbelievable.
The funny thing was at the opening of this, there were people standing all around, like probably good 150, 200 people. And a good friend of mine had his little daughter there. She's around six at the time. And I think the crowd and the heat and everything just got to her, and she just flipped out and just ran across the room. And there was like a palpable moment where the whole audience was like, and they're all looking at me like I'm going to freak out and go into an artist tantrum. I already took pictures, so I was cool. So, you know, I was all right. But, you know, she was just so quick that she so light-footed that it was like one tiny smudge, but the right kind of smudge, a smudge that let everyone know, oh my God, that's sand? You mean this whole thing? Oh, okay, so it's real? It's not glue on that? So it was just enough to give credence to the piece. Then everyone started clapping and screaming.
We didn't know how to respond. We were so nervous.
And then she started crying, and she ran out the door. Yeah. I haven't seen her since.
One thing I want to ask you, you know, as chefs, we're off the space is telling us what to cook sometimes. 15-seat restaurant is different than 150-seat restaurant. As an artist, when you go through, when you do restaurants program or when you have a big studio, like your studio now is very big, and then you go through smaller spaces. I've been at your apartment when you still created smaller pieces, but very intense work. Like, how does it, what is the size of the studio? Does it matter? It doesn't matter?
Yeah, size matters. That's what they say.
Yeah.
I want a bigger studio now because I need a place where I can compartmentalize. You know, I need a place where my keyboard and my drum machines need to be. I need wall space so the quilts and the drawings can be there. Then I need a workspace where I can make all, you know, sculptural stuff and map this kind of stuff out, you know. So I'm in the need finally for a big space where I can be for a long period of time. Because prior, like I was saying, you know, I was doing residencies or commission pieces, which would have me travel to different locations, and thusly I would work at those different locations. Now I want to, you know, be able to just stay in one, you know, area and be in New York and just build and build from that point. So I do need a little bit more space to do that.
You talk a lot about postmodern and post civil rights and being the first generation of hip hop. Do you think there's going to come a time, because part of your work talks about the black experience, and then there's part of your work that doesn't. Do you think we come to a time where black artists, black chefs, black creative people are just going to come to a time and just create art? And as it's not looking at the black journey. How do you think?
I don't know. I think it's sort of like a catch-22. Because there's part of me that loves to be able to say I'm a black artist. And I say black, not African-American. Black, post-civil rights, late 60s, 70s, black with an afro and some James Brown in the background. Yeah. Black. Because that's what I am. And
some
then there's and some fela popping, you know? But then there's the other side of me that was like, oh, why do we have to be black artists? Can't we just be artists? I mean, I get it, you know? And I make work that sort of speaks to that.
To both things.
But I guess the way I'm trying to come to grips with the whole thing is that none of us live in any specific monoliths at all. None of us are monoliths. Even as individuals, we're not monolithic. We change by the minute, change by the year, month, decade, and so on. So I think the perceptions will change to a degree, but just like you were saying earlier about putting sort of riffs and nods and acknowledgments to certain dishes, like you can make a riff off of pesto only if you understand pesto.
Yeah.
I think you can make a riff off of blackness only if you have some inkling of what blackness might be. And I don't know if that's post-black, because I have issues with the term post-black,
yeah,
because it's sort of redundant, being that black's in the title, so it's not really post. So, but it's a great soundbite, so I'll use it. But yeah, I mean, you know, I guess it's a work in progress.
But you know, if you look at Astrid Carter, like a Norman Lewis, for example, mm-hmm. do you see in his work, mm-hmm. like you must have been, I was always inspired by somebody like that, that just changed the game completely, just different. And mm-hmm. yes, the black art is abstract, but maybe it doesn't come back. And you have to, you look at the piece, you wouldn't know mm-hmm. anything, but then, you know, I'm sure it's there. And when you, in your abstract work, I mean, so I have pieces of from you that are, yes, you can definitely tell that this is an African-American artist or a black artist. And then you have a lot of pieces, your abstract pieces, where it's just beautiful put together.
You know, I only made around 5 of those abstracts, and you are one of the owners of one. A couple of other friends have those, and I love those pieces.
Love it.
I love, love those it. Pieces. I guess that's sort of the next phase for me, sort of, you know, going into work. Interestingly enough, I'm a bit methodical with the way I make work. Even this piece that's here right now, which I call Lotus. I'll show you another image of it, of the glass image. So this is sort of having my cake and eating it too. Mm-hmm. I call this Lotus because it looks like a lotus blossom from a distance. But when you get closer up, you realize that yeah. each of those petals are actually slave ships. And these are diagrams of how they used to pack bodies to bring yeah. them to Africa. Mm-hmm. So, in one sense, it's purely aesthetic,
yeah.
purely modernist, eye candy, seductive.
Yeah.
But the closer you get, you realize that there's a more sordid story
Absolutely.
Deeper in there. Like I say, layers. It's about having yeah. layers, complexity, and nuance in the work. But I go through these exercises of challenging preconceived symbols of our African diasporic history and trying to complicate those through repetition or context. Later, the next step would be to just disavow them totally. Get rid of the baggage, get rid of the pathology, get rid of the weight that's associated with this image or with that Cheshire grin, the smile that I was showing a little
yeah.
earlier. You know. So, you know, when this hangs in a tree in Germany, it's just Cheshire Cat
yeah.
from Lewis Carroll. But when this is shown in
yeah,
Virginia, it's blackface minstrelsy. Mm-hmm. And I'm interested in how those symbols can sort of bounce around, the meaning can bounce
nice.
Around. So ultimately, I'm trying to abstract and obliterate and make all these sort of, you know, make
but,
the past a bit more invisible.
But in cooking, for example, it's been for a long time, if you look at African Americans' contribution to cooking in America, you think about barbecue, you think about Southern experience in terms of soul food. Now that's very popular. And black people are actually not given the credit for it. Mm-hmm. This just now has this other thing, right? This is, it's, you know, on the one hand, it's very commercial, but on one hand, it's just young cooks being inspired by that and doing their own version of that.
Right.
Do you think it's going to come to term where, you know, because the music has happened forever, do you think it will come to a time where white artists are going to start doing black-themed work?
I thought about that a lot. I thought I wanted to curate a show of black art made by non-black artists
yeah.
at some point just to see how that worked. And before I met Phil, I was even thinking
no.
of doing Norman Rockwell pieces just to see if it made a difference that I did Norman Rockwell's.
Yeah.
But one thing that's interesting about the art world, and this might be controversial to some, but a lot of very popular black artists, there's a few that don't work this way. But one of the things that makes their work so accessible for the collectors, which are largely white, European, or whatever, is there's a black image. So the black abstract
oh.
artists don't always get the same
oh,
play as someone who's going to have a portraiture,
yeah, yeah.
whether it's sarcastic, cynical, or
yeah.
aggrandizing of black folks. So there are a few people who are doing abstract
wow.
black work. But even in Art Forum, I think it was around a year ago, and Julie Meritu and I had a big conversation about this. They listed the most influential abstract painters of the last 20 years or so. And of that list, there were no blacks, none. No Mark Bradford, no
yeah.
Julie Meritu, none. And there was like 2 women.
Mm.
So, you know, there is still that segregation there.
In our restaurant, we have a lot of art, and it's curated, and Sanford was by far, you know, one of the first people that we wanted to talk to. But I was also intrigued by, we have a young artist, a Jewish artist, that deals with a black subject. He considered himself an African-American artist. It's fascinating. So the first time he said that to me, I was like, You're joking? No. And then you realize how deep and how serious it is. And when you looked at a subject, you know, I have to give him that. And I have to think, in music, it's been done forever. You can be, you know, traditional, you know, it doesn't matter. But so in art, it is a little bit different.
Well, you reminded me. I showed a clip earlier of old family movies. There was a Jewish family on one side and my family on the other side. That was shown at the Studio Museum in Harlem at the legendary freestyle show. And when I proposed that show to go there, I mean that piece to go there, there was a bit of controversy because at that point they had not shown non-black artists. And my collaborator is a non-black artist, obviously, a Jewish one. So there was a moment where it was a little push and pull of whether they would include that or not at that time. Wow. Nowadays it doesn't matter. That they already jumped over that hurdle very quickly. But there was a moment where it was, you know.
No, but I think, you know, my family being mixed and my parents being white, my cousins being from Canada and Korea and Jewish aunt and black kids. So we had to deal with this at the dinner table, at our family gatherings. And I think maybe we're 15, 20 years away from, you know, when you think about adoption, when you think about cross, you know, now it's very clear that, oh, Asian or African kids are coming to the West. We may be 5-10 years away from Russian kids being adopted into Africa. Mm-hmm. No. So, you know, like it can all be changed in all of these conversations. That's why I feel like when I sit on a plane, when I go to Ethiopia, the call out for me is always that I'm white. Mm-hmm. So I always think this race is always a plane ride away for me. When I'm in Sweden, I'm American. Mm-hmm. When I'm in the States, I'm African-American. Mm-hmm. And when I'm in Africa, I'm white. Mm-hmm. So this is all a plane ride away.
Yeah, I got called a gringo in Senegal, so.
Yeah, absolutely.
Do you guys have any questions? Can we
Yes. Let's open it up.
Do you have any questions?
Black shows ushered you into mainstream?
I think it was one of the things that did, for sure. But I do credit the Studio Museum for introducing the New York art world to probably a good hundred black artists at this point, young black artists. So yeah, I think it's a pivotal situation there.
It was because of the exhibits and not because you were being considered not black or you were just an artist?
I think that was just a circumstantial thing because when I went to the Studio Museum, I went as a resident first, so I was one of the residents, and I was picked to be a resident by the former president, director of the museum, Kinshasa Conwell. So Thelma hadn't even gotten there yet. And during my tenure, Thelma came in, then I was out, you know, I finished my residency, and then she did the freestyle show. And she did that with that in mind, was to create a situation where artists were not weighed down by the notion of being black artists, AKA only black people would be interested in it, but making it post-black, where it's black artists that don't even have to deal with the subject matter of blackness at all. So it was, you know, definitely a gesture that had, you know, the waves and the ramifications are still being felt.
And also now, 10 years later, you have so many that came out of that era are traveling the world, are, you know, on major platforms. It was a stepping stone to where it is today, you know, and I think that aspirations is big too. By having something like that, it inspires a whole young generation of artists to say, you know what, I can get there. There's somebody listening to looking at what we're doing. I aspire to be in that museum.
The freestyle catalog itself has actually been put out in several art schools. So there's, so it's in the academy right now as one of the books that people refer to talk about the post-black movement and some of these artists, so.
Forgive me for asking so many questions, but I'm writing an article. Do you think we suffer as black people when we could be on the forefront of hip-hop art? We could be the leaders of it. Forgive my ignorance, I'm just learning by writing about it. But I know there's a lot of international hip-hop exhibits, or there have been, but being creators of hip-hop, we could be on the forefront as black quote-unquote artists. Do you think it does us a disservice to say we're post-black?
If it makes us talk about blackness at all, then it's not a disservice. That's the whole point. It's to proselytize people, make people think. It's not whether you believe in post-blackness, it's whether you're going to talk about blackness. That's what I think.
Thank you, that's brilliant.
This is for Mr. Yes Chef.
Nice. I never been referred to Mr. Yes Chef. I like that.
My husband was a chef and trained in France, yeah. And chef for 30 years, so I understand your pain and scars. What do you see, or how do you view the celebrity aspect of all this chef stuff on television that seems to have no relationship to being in the kitchen and working and having it be a intense, physical, laborious experience? It's very hard for us when people start, oh, you're a chef, and it's like, so I wanted to hear your perspective and if you feel, along with all the work you're doing in Harlem, what work you can do in terms of separating that out.
Yeah, no, there is no doubt that there's a confusion in the space. And a lot of people now, when I started cooking, there was one way to get into cooking, who works for the greatest chef that was in your neighborhood or your city, and then hopefully you got a chance to go to the next step. But it's love for the craft is still the same, right? Passion and commitment and love for the craft. And the good thing that that more people are into our field is that we're getting more application. Cooking as an industry, being a professional chef, the word, it's just been a profession in America since 1977. And now that people actually are considering, hey, should I be a lawyer or a chef, is an incredible achievement. And being online and being on TV helps that narrative a little bit. And I can tell you another layer where it does help. I just did a cooking demo in Harlem. We do one cooking class a month for free in the community. We just did a cooking class at the YMCA. I did a grilled chicken with couscous and feta salad and arugula. And this 13-year-old kid, innocent in Harlem, walks up to me and said, "Chef, is that feta or ricotta?" And I just looked at him and was like, "It's feta, that's great. Great guess. That's why you use less salt." "Yes, yeah, actually it is." "How would you know that?" I asked him. "Food Network." And then he just kept working. So he ate, he knew about, I didn't know about feta or ricotta when I was 13. So I understand the power of it, and it's about evolution. It's not often a blue collar job like cooking gets those high platforms. As long as you get into cooking for the reason, the love of the craft, it's okay if you saw it on TV, but because it's gonna take you about a week to figure it out. It's not a glamorous profession. It's glamorous if you love cooking, if you love to, I took beauty in somebody screaming at me in German, but also if you taught me how to carve a lamb. If you didn't teach me how to carve a lamb, then it was just screaming, then it was just noise. So it's okay, you know, if you understand and committed to the craft of cooking. And I think also that's why you see a lot of people come into the space. But it's about the same 25 people, still to this day, that run American food. Because they, I mean, if I asked, would Daniel Ballou cook with or without TV? Yes, he would. Yes, chef. And I can line up, like, would Alice still do it? She did. And she will keep, you know, Waxman. I can go through the whole list, right, all the way up to David Chang. The great ones will still do it.
I wanted to ask you, there was a few years ago, the critic Adam Gopnik, who writes about art and about food, once made an argument that art can be far more transgressive and experimental as an avant-garde practice than cooking. And I think he was thinking about just sort of transgressing social norms, because cooking still, no matter how avant-garde the chef is, has to please the palate, right? Whereas somehow art can be distasteful and get away with being credited as a great work. Now, I see where he's coming from, but there's something about that argument that just doesn't sit right with me. What do you think?
Absolutely, of course.
I mean, my initial response would be context. You know, of course, if you have to keep the doors open and feed a group of people is one thing. But in Documenta, the Documenta is a humongous international art show that happens every 5 years in Kassel, Germany. And the last iteration had the cook, Ferran Adrià. He was included, chef, included as an artist because of, you know, some of the incredible inventions and things that he's done in the culinary field. Also, decades before that, there was the Futurist Cookbook, which was, you know, obviously very transgressive politically and in terms of taste and all, anything you want to say. So I think I've always looked at food as an art. So I think there's a place for it to be as transgressive as anything, but there's just not the opportunity or those contexts aren't really available as frequently as they can be.
Well, I think there is a space, and I think the unknown world is I think Africa is key to that. Because in Africa, you can, since our side of the world doesn't know as much about Africa as Africa actually know about our side of the world. So there is actually an opportunity there if you want to do real creative cooking to go back and pull some textures and some ingredients that has been there forever, but then you marry that with techniques that Ferran maybe taught us, or that we learn, mix that with a Japanese texture or a technique. Now you're having food that sort of is out there and can be window opening for, can talk about working together, collaboratively, globally. It can touch on so many different platforms. So I do think it's always in the context of the knowledge of the person that eating or viewing the piece. And I feel very blessed that I have windows in to taking myself to places all over the world. When I go to a place like, you know, if I go to my wife's village in Ethiopia, and the way they eat raw meat, chunks of raw meat, it's not small chopped tartare, it's chunks, 4 or 5 ounce pieces of raw meat. And that texture, when you eat it, it's scary. But I'm like, you know, and I'm uncomfortable first. And you have about 200 people watching you being uncomfortable. That's the highest art. And then you gotta go, what's going on? So I will bring him there, I invite him there.
I also, really quickly, I was saying backstage that I think what Marcus has done, and I'm sure there's others that have, but I, you know his work intimately, is that some of the things he's done borders on social practice. In fact, the fact now that 125th in Lexington, or Lenox, is a destination for not just downtown diners, but international diners, is a political act. There is a bit of transgression there. And the fact that you can have soccer moms by the van load, sitting right there next to, you know, the old school Harlem dandy with his hat on and his pinstripe suit, the young hip hop kid who's got enough money to take his date out that night, and the gay Asian couple, and they're all sitting right there at the bar. Harlem didn't do that 5 years ago. So there is that political aspect too.
It's a pleasure to see you guys once again.
Hey,
how are you? First of all, this morning I saw an interview of Marcus on this online magazine called Tadias. That was really wonderful, and I thought the audience might enjoy it.
I love my Ethiopian sisters. We keep promoting our own selves. Tadias is an Ethiopian magazine. I love it.
Absolutely, and it's great.
Shout out
it's
to the Tadias. People. It's
Tadias.com, T-A-D-I-A-S. And Sanford is one of my favorite artists. It's wonderful to see you. I kind of had an idea when Sanford was saying, talking about Harlem and Red Rooster and whatnot, because the Romare Bearden exhibition is also in New York City right now, and Los Angeles has not done anything to celebrate his 100th birthday celebration,
I was thinking maybe there are people in this audience that might want to come to New York and go see the exhibition at the, what's the museum?
Newark Museum.
And come to Red Rooster and maybe even come to Sanford's studio. So if there's people who are interested in doing this thing, maybe they can sign up and it can be possibly arranged. You never know.
We also have Gordon Parks 100th coming up here in November.
And lastly, I want you to talk about, I know you're a painter and you're doing, well, you're not a painter.
Well, I don't at all consider myself a painter, but I just think that in my work of getting to the menu of Rooster, I have to collect and respect what was there before me. And since I was not born in Harlem, but has always been intrigued by that culture, I had to document a lot of work before, and it took me years to do that. And through reading James Baldwin or through just watching Civil Rights Movement and through watching just Romar and so many people, I started to do pieces about it. And most of those pieces in my home, and it helped me in shape the narrative of the menu of the restaurant. And I've always done work and kept it at home as a place for just another creative angle to shape the menu and shape the ultimate work for me, which is the restaurant and the connection with the people there. So.
Hi, this is for Mr. Biggers. My name is Chris. I've been in a couple of art shows, and so I'm not a professional artist, but I take it pretty seriously. I'm curious about your abstract works. I've done works, portraitures, everything I've done, people know what it is. It's a person, it's a cat, it's a dog, whatever. I'd like to experiment with abstract, but what's the difference between a good abstract and a bad abstract?
Well, wow. at the end of the day, I think it's a personal opinion, but what I would suggest is that you go check out as many abstract shows as you can, because, I know here in LA that you have a fair amount of museums and galleries that will show abstract work. And as you start to get closer and feel them, you can sort of feel what feels good. And when I say feel, literally, canvases, artwork speak. It's beyond what you see. There's an aura that comes off of good work. There's probably an aura that comes off of bad work, too. you probably won't feel that as quickly. But so that's what I would say. Any particular prescriptive thing that makes an abstract better than another? There's just so many different types of abstract. There's, schools of abstraction. So it's really sort of a detailed, much longer discussion. But the more you expose yourself, and I don't mean online. I mean like the real things. Because a lot of it becomes about scale, about texture, layers, transparency, all the various, very technical aspects of painting, or collage, or whatever that abstract artist may be doing. So I would say expose yourself with the real thing in person as much as possible.
Thank you. I have a question for both of you. You've both accomplished so much at a young age. What, let's say over the next 10 years, what is how would you like to challenge yourself? What is the biggest challenge for yourself coming up?
Very quickly, I would say to try to work beyond the limitations that I might have unconsciously set up for myself. I think the creative act is a very introspective one, but it's also a very generous one once given back out. And I think part of the inward journey of making that work is breaking down barriers, psychological, emotional, you name it. So I'd like to be able to experience that and produce from that type of space. I would also like to make work that does not have to be defined as post-black or black or abstract or realistic or anything. And I think the intent of a work is very, very important. It's as important as the actual output. And once again, like I said to this young lady here, it's the aura. I would like the work to have, when I say aura, I don't mean R. Kelly, I mean aura. I would like the aura to really be the thing that comes out of the work, beyond the visual. I mean, I do like the seduction of beauty and those things, or even the seduction of repulsion. But there's an emotive quality that I want the work to have.
For me, it's about the food chasm that we have in this country. We so much the answer and the problem to so many things when it comes to food. And I think as a chef, I have a responsibility there, especially as a chef that we're lucky enough that our restaurants are filled. So that first basic is already set. Now, if we have a platform, if we're given this opportunity and privilege to speak with the public, now what do we do with it? So how do we inspire, aspire? How do we work towards the food chasm? So whether that is a farmer's market in Harlem, not for 4 months a year, but for 12 months a year, and an affordable farmer's market, because it doesn't mean anything if it's not culturally or affordable, then it's just stuff, right? And to be working towards that is something that fuels me. And also eventually narrow the food chasm between the West and Africa in terms of food, because there is a lot to be done there. And I take that to heart. I think that that's something that is very important. Eating with a spiritual compass. We completely, so many of us are so lucky because we have food everywhere, but then we have other issues in terms of food. And I feel like chefs, we can actually be an answer or a guider in how to eat a little bit better beyond just the restaurant or beyond just cooking a tea. Really filling it with a learning experience that opens up dialogue between continents, between people. And that's why we put the restaurant in Harlem, because right there, so many people come from all over the world to look at what's going on in inner city of America. And when you come to Harlem, hopefully you can go back to your town, your community, be inspired by that, and activate that you're part of town. So I take that sincere.
Can you